I'm pleased to announce Mark Reimers. Mark will be speaking tonight on the neuropsychology of dogmatic belief and delusions. Mark is an associate professor in the neuroscience program at Michigan State University with training in mathematics and biomedical engineering. He studies the dynamics of brain activity, and his job is to read the minds of small animals. Mark, go ahead.
Great. Thank you, Kristen. I've started sharing screen, and I think you can you all see this? Are you seeing slides?
Yes.
Okay, great. Thanks. Now, I'll be telling you today some things that we think we know about something that is a real problem in the modern world. And I'd like to first, you know, raise the question, why do we care? And I think especially those of us who are engaged in trying to advocate for reasonable policies run into people who are not interested in evidence and are not interested in facts, but are interested in what seems to us something very strange. And we often think that, well, they're just bad people. But I don't think they are. And I think if we understand more about how people come to have dogmatic delusions, we may be in a better place. So, you know, we, in the last 3 years, many of us have tried to argue with the people in the top left. You're probably familiar with the longstanding disagreements with the folks in the top right in the megachurch. On the other side of the political spectrum, I think many of us may have friends who believe that vaccines are, an unnecessary intervention. At the same time, probably we've known people who've decided that, you know, we've gone off to some very strange religion. So I'm sort of illustrating the flying saucers coming down as the Raelians believe. So I would argue that, you know, aside from pandemics, probably one of the biggest threats to human happiness and perhaps even human life is our own craziness. And we'd like to understand why we can be so crazy. So what do we actually know in terms of brain science about dogma and delusion? So first, some bad news. The bad news is that we really don't have a very clear idea about how people come to believe dogmas or delusions. What evidence we have is mostly based on a few studies with small samples. And if you've been following some of the discussions about the reproducibility of scientific results, you probably realize that, well, you really should take everything that's based on a small sample with a big grain of salt. Now, some good news. We do actually have some evidence. I mean, these small studies are pretty consistent, at least in broad outline, about the kinds of brain activities that are going on. And if we interpret these together with some background information, I think the brain data do, in fact, give us a considerable insight into these longstanding puzzles. Now, I hope most of you are pretty skeptical, so I'm going to give you a note of caution. You may not be skeptical about the kinds of pictures I'm going to be showing you, like the picture on the right. I'll show you lots of pictures of brain areas being activated. And sometimes I get the feeling that many people, many humanists look at these pictures the way Christians look at holy icons, that this must be right. Well, again, all of these studies are based on small samples and statistical analysis. Again, you should take all of these with a grain of salt, maybe even two grains. So with that being said, I'll start showing you some. So I'd like to introduce some perspectives that are probably not very welcome to many of us, but I think will help us understand some of the issues. And then I want to talk a little bit about dogmatic personality, talk about personal delusions, that is, delusions that I may have that aren't widely shared, and then sort of bring it back to where we started, which is social dogmas and delusions, why, when a lot of people share a delusion. And then maybe say a few words about how we might push beyond where we are now. So first, some perspectives. So let me ask you, what are brains for? Why do you think we have brains? Well, you know, many of us, I think, would like to believe with the Greek philosophers that our brains are fundamentally engines of reason, that we have our brains in order to think great thoughts and plan great deeds. And I think 200 years ago, during the Enlightenment, when many of the thinkers we revere were writing, the kind of Christian pessimism suggested that human beings were incapable of working their way out of their problems, and that the only hope was to cast yourself upon the authority of the Catholic Church. So people like Voltaire and Rousseau didn't want to do that. They wanted to assert the human possibility. So they looked back to the classical Greeks and suggested that human minds have the innate capacity for reason. And that's a very attractive idea, one that we would like to, we would like to believe about ourselves. But I'd like to contrast that with perhaps a biological point of view, something that is more recent, and that is the brain didn't evolve to solve algebra problems or to look at the stars. The brain evolved to help our ancestors survive in a pretty harsh world. And if we think about our natural brain functions, they're much more likely to be about survival than about abstract reasoning. We have been, or our ancestors have been, surviving for millions of generations, but we've been reasoning perhaps for 20 or 30 generations. So what is sort of distinctive about the human species? Our bodies are not particularly imposing, but the thing we do that almost no other species does is we cooperate on large-scale projects. And whereas primates will get together occasionally for a short-term goal, for a common aim, no primate will sustain work on a project for days and days with the understanding that others are going to depend on him. So our ability to cooperate is the distinctive advantage that's enabled us to sort of dominate the world. But that leads to a big puzzle. So human beings evolved in small-scale societies, in groups of a few dozen, and cooperation there is already pretty complex. So how do you get 100,000 people or 1 million people to cooperate, such as was needed to build these pyramids? Well, that's one of the deep problems of anthropology. And I'm showing you here pictures on the left of the ruins of what we think was the first major building project in human history. And that is this place in Turkey called Göbekli Tepe. I think I haven't mangled it too badly, but well before agriculture, people gathered together and built these imposing Stonehenge-like structures. There's a reconstruction on the right. This is not what you would see today, but that's what we think was there, perhaps 12,000 years ago. And this has all the marks of what will later become temples. So somehow, in order to the first cooperative venture that humans engaged on was some kind of religious or perhaps ideological venture. Now, so the answer is that in order to get us to cooperate, in order for us to thrive as a species, we need to find something common to believe in. And that is not always going to be the truth. So let's take a bit of a detour to dogma. And I'm going to start with the individual. That is, what makes a dogmatic personality? And here's a sort of brief definition from the Encyclopedia of Group Processes. It's an intolerant and inflexible conviction in one's own beliefs. And dogmatic people tend to have a narrow political orientation and conform easily to authority, but be intolerant to those who are different. I think we all know dogmatic people. We may even know dogmatic people of our own religious or political persuasion. So what kinds of brain characteristics are associated with this kind of dogmatic or authoritarian belief tendency? So I'm going to give you several different perspectives on this question. They're not all completely consistent, and they all take a different aspect of the issue. But one of the most interesting correlates between human brain anatomy and human brain characteristics is actually in conservative social values. The picture on the left here, top left, is showing two brain regions that whose size, that is relative size relative to the rest of your brain, turns out to be surprisingly correlated with measurable personality characteristics. This is, to my knowledge, the biggest correlation between any brain size attribute and any personality or characteristic or mental trait. And that is that people with a very large ventromedial prefrontal cortex tend to value group loyalty and value and respect authority much more than people who have a relatively much smaller ventromedial prefrontal cortex. People who have a large insula, which is this little area off to the side, maybe I should orient you to this picture. So you're looking at two views of a human brain. The view on the left, I hope you can see my pointer here, is looking at a human brain as if it's been sliced in half down the middle, down the midline. And the area that's being pointed to here, this ventromedial prefrontal cortex, is more or less right behind your eyes or the bridge of your nose, perhaps 2 or 3 inches back from the bridge of your nose. And it turns out that people who have sort of more gray matter there tend to, and it's not perfect correlation, but tend to be more loyal to their friends, they tend to value group loyalty, and they tend to have greater respect for authority. Likewise, another brain region that is involved in conservative moral values is the insula, which is an area that's sort of tucked to the side. So this picture on the right, we're looking at a brain from the front as if the brain has been sliced in half, sort of from the crown of your head through your ears and down to your neck. No people were harmed in making these pictures. These are actually magnetic resonance image pictures, which show you a sort of virtual inside view. Now, so the insula, if you were to try to find it on your brain, there'd be two of them, one on the left and one on the right, and they'd be more or less just in front of your ears and about an inch down. And again, people who have more gray matter there tend to be more concerned with group loyalty. They also tend to be more concerned with purity, sort of keeping themselves away from whatever they consider contagious. Maybe that's not a bad habit to have sometimes. Now, this is a very strong correlation, but we don't know what causes what. We don't know which came first. Were people born with this neuroanatomy and then they became more concerned with conservative values? Or were they raised in a family that was concerned with conservative values and they developed this region? At the moment, we can't tell. This study is only a few years old, and we haven't looked at the sort of causal relationships. Certainly both could be true. So that's just a sort of introduction to one slant on a concern with authority or respect for authority. I'm going to turn to something different now, and that is religious belief. So many of you know the work of Sam Harris, a philosopher, but he's also done a PhD in neuroscience, and he was interested in the neuroscience of belief and faith and argument. And he read statements to people were statements about just facts that everyone could agree to, or also religious beliefs that only some of the people would agree to. And notice that, again, this is a picture on the right here, the top right, looking at a brain as if it's been sliced down the midline. And what these orange squares, this orange outline represents is the region of the brain that seemed to be working harder when people were advancing a belief rather than something that they knew for a fact. And again, you notice that this is this very close to this same ventromedial prefrontal cortex. This is the frontal pole and orbital frontal cortex, closely related. Now this study has been replicated with a slightly different set of statements and finding very much the same kind of thing. So it's these areas that are concerned with loyalty and with authority that actually get activated when you're asserting your belief in something that's really a matter of faith. Okay, now what about dogmatism? That's a little hard to study, but we can study overconfidence. So part of dogmatic belief is that you're not really willing to listen to other people. You are very confident that you are right. And again, we see here not a difference in brain anatomy, but rather that people who are overconfident, meaning that their performance doesn't really justify the confidence, tend to show what we call a greater connectivity between these medial frontal areas that I've mentioned already and other regions of the brain, so that there's greater communication between these areas concerned with your social relationships and every other part of your brain. That's not conclusive evidence, but it's certainly suggestive that perhaps all these other parts of your brain are sort of checking in to find out if seeing this or thinking this is really going to be acceptable to your family and friends. Now, just a few years ago, and 8 years after the original study, Sam Harris, who's now able to pay people to do research for him, supervised a study where people were challenged with evidence contradicting their beliefs. And he noticed, again, which brain areas tended to be active when people resisted evidence So he identified people's beliefs that were, you know, questionable, certainly, and then presented them with factual evidence challenging those beliefs, and found again that areas that are typically associated with relation, in this case, not the ventromedial prefrontal cortex, but areas associated with theory of mind and understanding other people, were more activated in people who resisted changing their beliefs based on evidence compared to people who weren't. So I think that overall we do have a convergence, even though each of these studies by themselves is relatively small and perhaps insufficient to have much confidence in, the fact that they all seem to point to the same or perhaps similar sets of areas suggest that that beliefs are primarily about maintaining your important social relationships, that you don't go through life, in fact, rationally evaluating all of your beliefs. So let me pause there and take some questions. All right, so I'd like to talk a little bit about delusions and how they come about. So I'm not going to talk much about real clinical or psychiatric delusions, because I think we're trying to understand how more or less normal people can hold a belief that is utterly bizarre. So I'm not going to be talking about people who believe that the CIA has implanted a radio in their tooth. But I'm going to talk about delusions that might be held by people who otherwise seem fairly normal, who can carry on a conversation and who can hold down a job and perhaps maintain relationships, but seems to be utterly bizarre. So I'm just taking as an example people who believe that they have been abducted by aliens and subjected usually to some kind of probing, often of a sexual nature. There are plenty of people walking around now. There used to be many more, apparently, who really believe that they had been abducted by aliens and who said that only when they had realized that, then everything about their lives made sense. That's not very much evidence. And I think we would all agree that it's unlikely, very unlikely, that anything like what they describe has actually happened to them. But it's certainly something that many people firmly believe and regard as central to their identity. So how do you become deluded? Well, there are many ways to become deluded that we probably don't know anything about, but I'm going to tell you about one fairly common way, and that's sort of touching something that you might like to think of as unshakable. That is your own life story, your own memory. Some of you may know about, if you've taken a psychology of memory class, may know about the experiments that show that even very very important trenchant memories, like where were you when the Challenger exploded, or where were you on 9/11, can often be distorted by time. And it seems that one of the most effective ways of distorting a memory is to tell a story, because you can often get an enthusiastic audience, and they will reinforce the aspects of the story that that they can make the most sense of, that they that they feel validates the group identity or validates their own experience. And if you tell a story often enough, then in many cases, it doesn't happen to everybody and it doesn't happen to all stories, but in many cases the story will mutate to adapt to the enthusiastic audience. And it's often, a number of studies of how memories become distorted find that it's the people who talk about the most often who seem to have the most distorted memories. When a Cornell University psychologist did this with people right after the Challenger disaster, he asked them to write down, you know, the day after, to write down where they were and who they were with and what they were doing when they heard. And then he asked these same students 2 years later to write down the same answers to the same three questions and compared them. And only about 40% of people got all three roughly right. It's a very sobering study, and that's been replicated many times in several cultures. So it's not a fluke. Now you could do experiments, and this has been done recently. If you bring people into an experiment, and then they have some experiences, and then you bring them back and you tell them about something that had happened while they were there, that isn't actually true, you can induce about 40% of them to go along with you. And now some of that is they're just going along to be polite, and some of that is they've really believed it. So what these experimenters did was to bring them back a third time, and then they told them the truth. They said, you know, what we told you last time was just a lie. You know, we made it up. So what do you think people will do? Well, about half the people who had previously conformed and repeated what the experimenters' confederates had told them, about half of them said, okay, then I don't have to say this crap anymore. I'll tell you what really happened. And they then tell something like what they actually experienced. But about half those people, even after hearing that they had been misled, insisted that this was not true, that in fact what they had been told was actually what they had experienced, that that's actually what had happened to them. And these experimenters said, well, those are the really interesting people. So now that's a large fraction of the population. That's, you know, more than 20% of the whole experimental group persisted in this delusion. And they said, well, how, okay. So they had the advantage of having a magnetic resonance scanner there. So they asked, what's going on in their brains? And they had the foresight to do this while they were telling them the distortions. So what they found was that it was the people who, when they heard the distortion, were very active in areas of the brain related to social relations that were the most likely to persist in the false memory after it had been shown to be false. So I think there's lots of ways in which we can become committed to a delusion. But I think one of the most important ways is that it meets part of our emotional need for social connection. So let's think about a little bit more about the impact on society here. So I'd like to come back to the kinds of questions that we started with, which is how do we get from a sort of divided society to agreeing on at least some core facts. And one of the interesting findings has been about the relationship between cognitive flexibility, that is, can you look at things from different perspectives, and political leanings. So before I show you the data, let me ask you this. Who do you think is more likely to be inflexible or rigid in their thinking? Would you say that would be followers of the current president of the United States, or would you say that's more likely to be followers of Bernie Sanders? Just think about that for a second.
Do you want people to respond on the chat?
No, they don't need to respond. I just want them to think about it. So I see something on the chat about the name of the study. I can get that for you. It's on my screen, but not up front right now. I can get that. So here's the data. This was a study that was actually published just last year by some folks at the University of Cambridge. And they gave a number of tests of cognitive flexibility to people in this country with various political affiliations. So they recorded both their political affiliation and their results of these independent tests of cognitive flexibility. And the results for one of the tests are shown here on the left. And so there's three groups. Each dot here represents one individual, and the cognitive flexibility score is on the left here. So the higher up the dot is, the more flexible the person is. So this person was almost off the charts on cognitive flexibility, really supple thinker.
Mark, you'll need to reshare your screen so we can go along, follow you.
I'm sorry. Did I not share screen?
You took it down during the Q&A and then didn't put it back up yet.
I'm sorry. Let me do that. There we are. My apologies.
There you go.
Okay, here we are. Sorry about that. Okay. So here's the data. Let me start again here. My apologies about that. So each dot on this picture on the left here represents scores for one individual. So this person whose score is represented by this dot is sort of off the charts in terms of cognitive flexibility, someone a really supple thinker. Can you see this now?
Yes.
Okay, great. I think I left you with political parties and they did a further study where they actually did a quantitative measure of political polarization, and they found that people who were maybe somewhat left of center seemed to have the highest overall scores of cognitive flexibility, but that people who were at either end of the political extreme, as it is now in America, seem to have significantly less cognitive flexibility. And it's sort of interesting that, while in some sense, the most flexibles are somewhat left of center on average, it seems like both left and right extremes don't have as much cognitive flexibility. So I think we should ask then, under what conditions does reason flourish? And I think maybe some of us in the older generation may remember this picture, which was, of course, an ancient artifact even when I was a child. But this is one of the sort of famous paintings commemorating the four freedoms that Franklin Roosevelt celebrated. And this is the freedom of speech. This fellow is in a New England town hall meeting, and it's pretty clear that not many people like what he's saying, but they're listening. And that's, I think, a precondition for any kind of rational discourse. And I think it's worth remembering, we talk about reason and rationality, and the root of that is in fact, the Latin word ratio, which we pronounce ratio, and it's really a comparison. It's a place where you can get together and weigh the two arguments. What we really need, I think, in order to encourage the practice of reason is the space to compare weights of arguments. So I'm going to end with asking, how are people who are this committed to a delusion going to come to listen? And I think that we, especially, the intellectuals in the United States have forgotten something that's pretty important. And that is that people are more likely to listen if their own needs, for food, shelter, status, are being met, or they have a reasonable prospect of being met. And, if we ask what's happened, in the United States that has sort of impelled people to embrace these kinds of desperate, deluded ideologies, I think we should ask about the life experience of people, that many of their parents sort of lived at a time when it seemed like their incomes would only go up, when auto workers could have second homes, those days are gone. Their parents looked forward to a future, but they don't. And I think if we're going to take seriously, what we would need to do in order to sort of make America sane again, reasonable again, I think we should ask about, what are the real prospects of the 99% or maybe the 90%. I'm a professional, I'm going to do reasonably well. But, what about the 90% who don't have the privileges and skills that I have? So I think I'll end it there for now. Some other possibilities as well, but the one that we had talked about is something that's more a hobby of mine rather than part of my research. And it's called Societies That Worked When We Almost Got It Right. And that's looking at societies that were, as far as we can tell from archaeological evidence, pretty just, pretty creative, pretty advanced, but that by and large got steamrollered by history. So we'll talk about four of those societies. Probably the preeminent example is that at least I hadn't heard of until a few years ago, was Indus Valley Civilization. So we'll do that. I also wanted to, if it's not out of place, I was going to suggest maybe a course related to the brain, just as a thought.
Oops. So I think that we have lots of opportunities to draw upon Mark's talents and, yay, this was so fun. So I'm going to call it a night and we will send out more information. Feel free to email us about your ideas or your thoughts. And hopefully we can get a humanist happy hour scheduled and have more conversations about the human brain.
Sure, that would be great. Okay, well, look forward to seeing some of you again in 3 weeks. Thank you, Kristen and Emily, for setting this up. And Thank you all for joining. It's great to talk to an enthusiastic audience. I wish I'd opened it up for questions earlier, maybe talk less. But good to hear from you.
All right, bye everybody, good night.